Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahirrabbilalamin. Wabihi nasta'inu ala umuri dunya watin. Assalatu wassalamu ala asrofil anbiya'i wal mursalin. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Rabbi srohli sadri wa yassirli amri. Wahlul uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Amma ba'du. Good morning, Bapak-Bapak and Ibu-Ibu. Welcome back again and again to the Welcoming the Golden Years event, proudly brought to you by the one and only Muhammadiyah and Aisyah Australia 2020. I would like to say, oh, hang on, my voice is not very clear, yeah? I think, just give me 1 second. You hear me clearly now or still not really?
For me, it's clear.
Okay. Clear? It's clear, yeah. Okay. I would like to say welcome to those of you who have just joined in into today's session. And welcome back to most of you who have been tuning in every second Saturday. Alhamdulillah, we are entering our fourth session today. Yes, it's our fourth session, and I hope that we're still going strong as our topics are becoming more and more interesting every single week. And I hope that you're not bored seeing me again and again. And for those of you who haven't tuned in before, my name is Farah, and I will be moderating today's session again, inshallah. First of all, I would like to mention that Muhammadiyah and Aisyah Australia acknowledge the traditional owners of country throughout Australia and recognize their continuing connection to land, water, and culture. We pay our respects to the elders past, present, and emerging. And before we start, I would also like to thank Bapa-bapa, Ibu-ibu, brothers and sisters for participating in our fourth session today. Alhamdulillah, last session we had a very interesting topic about health and well-being for elderly, which was delivered by Dr. Erika. And we did have some very interesting questions that came up from the audience, and we all felt like there wasn't enough time for us to cover all the questions. Therefore, today we're having the second part of the same topic, which is about health and well-being for elderly, with a focus on respiratory health. And this one is going to be delivered by a doctor specializing in the field, Dr. Putri Ramadhani. I would like to greet Dr. Putri. Assalamualaikum, Dr. Putri. How are you today?
Good. How are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm good as well. And not only that, we will also have a discussion about the importance of exercise and nutrition, which is going to be delivered by Sister Lulu Eckert from Fit Sisters Melbourne. Now, I'm not sure if Sister Lulu is here already or not. Assalamualaikum, Sister Lulu.
Waalaikumsalam, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm good as well. We're very lucky today to have Dr. Putri and Sister Lulu, and I'm very excited for our session today, and may Allah make it easy for us to learn and absorb the knowledge. Amin, ya Rabbal Alamin. Before we start our session, let's start with some Quran recitation, which will be recited by the lovely siblings, Sister Akilan Hadi and Sister Nuha Hadi. They will be reciting the Quran, Surat Luqman, ayat 14 and ayat 15. So we invite everyone to listen attentively. It's Surat Luqman ayat 14 and ayat 15. So Sister Akila and Sister Nuha, if you're ready, the time is yours.
Bismillahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wa wassayna al insana bi walidayhi hamalathu ummuhu wa hanan ala wahnihi wa fisaluhu fi 'amayni an ishkur li wa li walidayka ilayya al masir wa in jahadaka 'ala an tushrika bi ma laysa laha bihi 'ilmun fala tuti'huma wa sahibhuma fid dunya ma'rufa وَتَبِعْ سَبِيلَ مَنْ أَنَابَ إِلَيْهِ ثُمَّ مَرْجِعُكُمْ فَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful. Knowing having joined upon man care for his parents. His mother carried him, increasing her weakness upon weakness, and his weaning is in 2 years. Be grateful to me, to your parents, and to me. By a day endeavor to make you associate with me, though of which you have no knowledge, do not obey them, but accompany them in this will with appropriate kindness, and follow the way of those who turn back to me in repentance. Then to me will be a return, and I will inform you about what you used to do.
Masya Allah, Jazakillah Khair, Sister Akilan, Sister Nuha. What a beautiful recitation indeed. I would like to mention again that in this ayat, Allah specifically said, be grateful to me and to your parents. So in this ayat, we can clearly see that Allah in fact put our parents next in line, right after Allah himself, that we need to be grateful to them. So may Allah make us among his people who are always grateful for our parents. Amin ya rabbal alamin. And just before we start, I would also like to mention a little bit about our program in partnership with IMCV, and it's called Small Kindness Community Care. Again, it's a collaborative initiative by Indonesian Muslim and wider Muslim community in Victoria to deliver essential items to those who are in need, regardless of religious or racial backgrounds. And we do have a hashtag that we use to promote our platform, and it's hashtag Stronger Together. But we also have a little bit about video about this program. MCV Small Kindness Community Care would like to say a massive thank you for your generous donation and continuous support to our organization. Unfortunately, last month, almost half of our recipients in southeastern suburb were in risk of not getting the much needed voucher and food hamper. And we need your help so we can continue to provide for them. Good news is some of our recipients started to get some jobs. However, there are many more who are still in need of our assistance due to various reasons. And if you would like to show some support by giving donation or becoming the volunteers, please feel free to contact us and we will direct you to the right people, inshallah. Okay, now it's the time for our main session. I would like to let everyone know that we will have a Q&A session at the end. So if any question comes up during the session, please feel free to write them in the chat box below and we can ask them during the Q&A session. So our first guest speaker for today is Dr. Putri Suci Ramadhani. If we can share the PowerPoint slide. Okay, so Dr. Putri is registered with Indonesian Medical Council as respiratory physician in Indonesia. But not only that, Dr. Putri is also registered as a medical practitioner in Australia. She did her Bachelor of Medicine and Medical Doctor, as well as Master of Health from Universitas Pajajaran Indonesia. She did her respiratory physician training at Persahabatan Hospital, Universitas Indonesia, and is currently a PhD candidate at Faculty of Medicine at Monash University. Dr. Putri has had many years of experience in both Indonesian hospitals as well as Australian hospitals as registrar in lung and respiratory department. Dr. Putri has also achieved many achievements in her field, as you can see on the slide. And on top of all that, Dr. Putri is a mom of two beautiful children, mashallah. Very, very specialized in your field, Dr. Putri, indeed. So today, Dr. Putri will be sharing with us with the topic of aging lung and its impact to your breathing. So I think without further ado, Dr. Putri, the time is yours.
Thank you so much, Farah, for introducing me. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And I also would like to thank to the committee, Muhammadiyah, that I feel humbled to be given this opportunity. And alhamdulillah, until now, Allah give us good health. And yeah, inshallah, I'll share my knowledge about respiratory health. Let me share the screen. All right. So if in the slides there are still some medical jargons, I'm sorry about that. But I will try to explain as easy as so everyone can understand, inshallah. So the title for this morning is the aging lung and its impact to your breathing. I will also explain in bahasa Indonesia, inshallah. So jadi pagi ini akan membahas tentang bagaimana sih penuaan pada organ paru dan efeknya terhadap pernafasan kita. Before I explain about how the impacts of the aging itself to the lung, we need to know the breathing process itself. So what is actually the main function of the breathing? The main thing is actually the gas exchange. So we have to, the body, so with the breathing, we breathe in, so we get the oxygen to our body and remove the carbon dioxide from our body. So there are two phases here, inspiration or we call it inhaling, inhale. So with inhaling, there is a muscle, we call it diaphragm. All right, I'll use pointer. So with inhaling, there is a muscle we call diaphragm, which do some contractions and it moves down. And it causes, and also there is a rib muscle here, it expands. And both of these actions cause the lung volume increases. And at the same time, as we know in, there is law that if the volume increase, there will be decreasing in the pressure. So the pressure inside the lung will be decreased. That's why the air from the outside can go into the lung. And the opposite of the inspiration, actually the difference between those two actions with exhaling or expiration, it is actually the passive process in normal condition. So again, the diaphragm as the main muscle of this breathing process. So the diaphragm will be relaxing. And what happened with the relaxing of the diaphragm, the rib cage retracts, okay? And the lung volume itself will be decreasing. And with the volume decreased, the pressure will be opposite, will be increasing. And the pressure will, so it can expel the air that from the lung to the air, from the lung to the outside, I mean. Ya, jadi ada dua proses dalam proses pernafasan kita, yaitu proses inspirasi atau kita bernafas ya, inhalasi, atau dan yang kedua adalah ekspirasi atau ekshalasi. Jadi pada proses inhalasi, jadi proses pernafasan ini yang paling penting ada otot yang bernama diafragma, dan juga di sini yang terlibat juga ada otot otot ribs ya, disebutnya intercostal muscle. Nah, jadi ketika kita bernafas, kita breathe in. Okay. Nah, itu diafragmanya akan turun, akan mendatar. Nah, terus otot ribs-nya, otot tulang rusuk kita akan ke depan, dan ini akan menyebabkan, jadi intinya kita terjadi volume parunya akan mengembang. Dan ketika volume paru mengembang, maka tekanan akan berkurang, ya. Jadi ada hukum fisika ya, volume meningkat maka tekanan akan menurun. Nah, jadi tekanan dalam paru itu akan menurun. Nah, ini yang menyebabkan tekanan kan akan dari tinggi ke rendah ya. Makanya itu kita tekanan udara yang tinggi di luar menyebabkan udara bisa masuk ke dalam paru kita. Dan sebaliknya, pada proses ekshalasi, pada proses kita ekshalasi mengeluarkan nafas, itu diafragma kita, otot diafragma kita akan relax. Dan kalau relax, itu malah akan ke atas, jadi malah akan cekung seperti ini. Nah, ini akan menyebabkan volume paru kita akan berkurang, dan tekanan di dalam paru meningkat, itu yang akan menyebabkan udara akan keluar. Oke. Okay. Maaf saya agak lama di sini karena ini nanti akan penting dalam proses aging selanjutnya. Sorry it took me a bit long here because this is the process that actually important to know with the aging process itself. All right. So with the lung and aging, at what stage is actually we reach the maximum growth of the lung? It's actually until 10 up to 12 years old. And it gets mature until age of 20 for female and 25 years old for males. And then after that, since then, the lung function will decrease by increasing of age. But the thing is, what make it different? The decline is will be massive, will be steeper for those who have lung disease. And I will underline here, for smokers, yeah. Nah, so with those who non-smokers or not doesn't have any pre-existing lung disease, they will still have the decline of the lung function, but it's just gradually. Jadi apa sebenarnya gimana hubungan antara proses penuaan dan organ paru kita? Jadi sampai umur berapa sih kita mencapai pertumbuhan ya, perkembangan dalam pertumbuhan organ paru kita? Itu sebenarnya hanya terjadi pada sampai usia 10 sampai 12 tahun. Dan terus mengalami perkembangan pematangan ya. Jadi pertumbuhannya sampai 10-12 tahun, namun proses pematangannya dalam arti mencapai fungsi maksimal itu pada perempuan di usia 20 tahun dan pada laki-laki di usia 25 tahun. Nah, sejak usia itu maka akan terjadi penurunan fungsi paru. Semakin tua akan semakin menurun. Tapi yang membedakan apa? Yang membedakan pada perokok pada orang yang memiliki penyakit paru sebelumnya, misalnya mungkin asma atau asma lah yang paling mudah ya. Nah, itu penurunan fungsi parunya akan lebih besar dibandingkan yang tidak punya penyakit paru sebelumnya atau bukan perokok. Nah, ini we come to the main point. So what happened with the aging and the in relation with the lung? So as we know before, the breathing process not just involve the lung organ itself. So it involves many muscles, especially the diaphragm, and also the bones, yeah, the bones who keep the lung who keep the lungs safe, and also the bone here also has muscle. We call it intercostal muscle, which can make the lung expand flexible. So if the with aging, there will be change to our bones, and also change to the muscle of the chest and the spine. First, I will talk about the bones. So here, the shape of our chest, the shape of our chest will change. Yeah, will change due to the age, like the thickness of the intervertebral disc, and also, of course, it will lead to decreasing of the volume of inside the chest cavity itself. Secondly, as the age, as Dr. Erica has mentioned before, it's really associated with osteoporosis, which may cause the fracture of the vertebrae of the body of the what do you call vertebrae in lay term, Farah? So vertebrae is vertebrae tulang belakang ya kalau bahasa Indonesianya ya. And resulting in the changes in the shape of the thorax itself. And thirdly, the stiffness of the ribs. So the ribs here will become stiff by increasing of the age. Therefore, the chest needs to be struggled and it becomes struggle to expand the movement of the lung. Jadi, pada slide ini akan mulai membahas apa yang terjadi, perubahan-perubahan apa yang terjadi dengan proses penuaan ya, terhadap proses pernafasan. Jadi bukan hanya organ paru, seperti kita sudah bahas di awal, bahwa pernafasan itu tidak hanya melibatkan organ paru saja, tapi di sini ada otot yang utama berperan dalam proses pernafasan, namanya otot diafragma. Dan di sini bone dulu yang dibahas ya, tulang dulu ya. Jadi yang pertama terjadi pada proses penuaan akan terjadi penebalan pada tulang lah ya, pada tulang-tulang yang di dada, di ribs ya, dan itu akan mengurangi volume di dalam rongga dada. Nah, kemudian pada proses penuaan juga akan terjadi osteoporosis ya. Kalau kita tidak memperhatikan ya dari muda ya, intake kalsium kita dan kita membiarkan saja ya tulang kita mengalami osteoporosis dengan sendirian ya, akan terjadi proses akan terjadi resiko yang lebih meningkat seperti proses fraktur ya, patah pada tulang vertebranya, dan ini otomatis akan merubah bentuk rongga dada itu sendiri ya, dan juga di sini bisa terjadi proses kekakuan pada ribs ya, dan akan menyulitkan ketika organ paru harus bernafas ya, harus mengembang. Kemudian, we talk about the changes about the muscle. So as I mentioned before, diaphragm and intercostal muscles are two main muscles that are really important for breathing process. And with aging, these muscles will be weakened. And of course, it will affect the breathing pattern itself. And the oxygen level that come to our body may become lower, and also less carbon dioxide removed. That's why a shortness of breath and tiredness may happen. Jadi yang kedua adalah perubahan pada otot ya. Seperti saya sudah bahas sebelumnya bahwa otot yang paling berperan penting dalam proses pernafasan adalah otot diafragma, juga otot interkostal. Nah, otot kedua otot ini seperti pada otot-otot lainnya, sejalan dengan proses penuaan, maka kita akan mengalami otot-otot kita akan mulai mengalami kelemahan. Dan ketika mengalami kelemahan, maka ini akan mempengaruhi kekuatan otot kita untuk bisa inhalasi, untuk ekshalasi, sehingga oksigen yang masuk ke dalam paru, organ paru kita akan rendah, lebih rendah, dan kekuatan kita untuk ekshalasi tadi, untuk expel the air juga akan berkurang, sehingga karbon dioksida yang harusnya dikeluarkan itu akan masih terjebak di organ tersebut, di organ paru tersebut. Okay. I just want to explain in this picture that this is a difference between the youth and the aging lung. So the number of alveoli, alveoli is So this is alveoli. So this is lung, and the lung has before it comes to the lung organ, we have airway here, the trachea, we call it windpipe, and then after trachea they have some branches, we call it bronchial and bronchus and bronchial, and this is the smallest one, is we call it alveoli. In this alveoli, there is some gas exchange, yeah, which really important. Jadi organ paru itu tidak bekerja sendiri, ya. Jadi ada saluran nafas. Saluran nafas itu mulai di sini dari trakea. Trakea nanti akan bercabang menjadi bronkus, kemudian jadi bercabang lagi lebih kecil menjadi bronkiol, dan yang paling kecil adalah alveoli. Di alveoli ini akan terjadi pertukaran gas, ya, O2 dan CO2 yang nanti akan dia akan exchange-nya akan bertukar di kapiler-kapiler paru, dan ya intinya akan terjadi pertukaran gas itu. Okay, go back to the slide here. So with aging, there are the number of alveoli is not reduced. But there are some changes with the structure. So the alveoli become larger and the elasticity become decreased. And there is also here, yeah, this is also about alveoli. The thing is, so as I explained before, that the ability for older people to exhale, to inhale and especially to exhale is not as good as a youth. So what happened, as you can see, there is an arrow here, yeah? With the age, with the lung aging, there is still leftover air that trap more here, okay? And that's why the carbon dioxide will become more trapped in aging lung. Okay, jadi di sini di gambar ini saya hanya ingin memperlihatkan bahwa pada proses penuaan jumlah alveoli tetap, ya, jadi tidak ada yang tidak berkurang gitu. Alveoli tadi yang organ yang apa jaringan terkecil, ya, yang berfungsi untuk pertukaran gas. Nah, ini tidak berkurang, tapi terjadi perubahan struktur, terjadi perubahan bentuk. Yang tadinya dia bentuknya bagus, ya, bulat-bulat gitu. Nah, ini jadi membesar, kemudian juga elastisitasnya jadi berkurang. Dan itu tidak bagus untuk proses pertukaran gas. Sehingga gas CO2 yang seharusnya kita memang normalnya kita memang tetap punya leftover, ya, tetap punya sisa udara yang di dalam organ paru kita. Tapi ya itu hanya untuk proses normal seperti itu. Tapi di sini pada proses penuaan gas yang sisa itu akan lebih banyak gitu, sehingga akan menyebabkan karbon dioksida di organ paru akan menumpuk lebih banyak. Oke. This is to differentiate with the aging lung and how make it different with the aging lung and also that person's smokes, yeah. So with the lung aging, I already explained, yeah, that the alveoli become larger and reduce the there is elasticity become reduced, but there is no such like this, yeah. So with the in people who smokes, so what happened? First, it's actually also the alveoli become larger and reduce the and the elasticity become decreased. But another thing that also happened, there is with the noxious gas that produced by the cigarettes, it will the lung cells become inflamed, and here more carbon dioxide, so the lung will become inflamed, and the alveoli become harder to be function as supposed to. So the gas exchange become has more trouble here. So the carbon dioxide become more trapped. Ya, jadi di sini saya akan menjelaskan bahwa apakah nantinya orang-orang yang mengalami penuaan, tadi kan dijelaskan bahwa akan terjadi penurunan fungsi paru, alveolinya akan berubah, terus sama aja dong dengan ya udah misalnya pada orang yang perokok ya mungkin excuse gitu. Jadi iya sama aja, toh nanti saya tua juga akan berubah gitu fungsi paru saya, fungsi jaringan-jaringan sel-sel paru saya. Ternyata berbeda ya, Bapak Ibu. Jadi pada orang yang mengalami penuaan tapi tidak merokok, karbon dioksida yang tadi yang terjebak itu akan jauh lebih sedikit dibandingkan dengan orang yang mengalami penuaan dan merokok, ya karena gas-gas racun yang dihasilkan oleh rokok itu akan menyebabkan jaringan alveoli akan mengalami inflamasi, akan mengalami peradangan, dan itu akan sangat menyulitkan bagi alveoli untuk melakukan tugasnya, ya, untuk melakukan pertukaran gas, sehingga oksigennya juga makin sedikit yang masuk dan karbon dioksidanya makin banyak yang terjebak. Akhirnya lama-kelamaan ya organ parunya akan seperti ini, namanya emphysema. So in later on with people who smokes, the lung will develop as like emphysema lung, or we call it COPD. Yeah. So I just want to emphasize here also with the COPD, apart from the alveoli itself, but there is also some changes. There are also some changes in the bronchiole, yeah, the airway before the alveoli. It becomes stricter, and if we have some mucus, it will become clogged there, and it's harder to take it out. And what happened, it will be risk for infection. Jadi pada orang-orang yang mengalami emfisema parunya, ya, mengalami PPOK kalau bahasa Indonesianya atau COPD, selain terjadi perusakan pada alveolinya, itu juga terjadi kerusakan, terjadi perubahan struktur, perubahan bentuk pada saluran nafas yang sebelum alveoli, namanya bronkiol, ya. Jadi akan mengalami penyempitan, sehingga otomatis dong kalau misalnya sempit, dia akan ketika kita ada lendir yang harus kita keluarkan gitu ya, itu akan lebih susah dan kalau lendir tidak dikeluarkan akan menjadi resiko infeksi. That's why in COPD patients they have more risk to get infection ya, yeah? Like pneumonia. Sehingga pada pasien-pasien dengan PPOK, COPD, mereka mendapatkan resiko yang lebih untuk infeksi paru seperti pneumonia, ya, yeah, and at current situation COVID-19. Okay, this is just to sum up there. So with aging, there is increased the stiffness of the chest wall, so the lung become harder to expand, and also decrease muscle mass. The diaphragm will become weaker, and also reduce the clearance. Yeah, as I explained, our ability, the ability to take the mucus out, and also the alveoli become enlarged, and it's not good for the gas exchange. Okay, lastly is about the changes to immune system. As we know that by aging, our immune system will decrease, and also it happened with the lung. So the natural defense mechanism of the lung to fight the infection, to fight the any risk for infection, it will be reduced. So of course the risk of getting infection become higher, and in current situation that's why in elderly people it's getting higher risk for getting like COVID-19 because there is change in our immune system. So and it will become worse if someone smokes because there is some. It will stimulate, we call it free radical, reactive oxygen species, or we call it free radicals that will destroy more the lung. Jadi pada proses penuaan juga terjadi perubahan fungsi imun kekebalan tubuh ya. Sejalan dengan penuaan, maka kekebalan tubuh kita akan menurun. Dan ini akan menyebabkan kita akan mudah lebih terinfeksi, organ paru kita akan lebih mudah terinfeksi. Nah, tapi ini akan juga diperberat ketika seseorang merokok. Oh ya, saya mau menekankan lagi bahwa merokok di sini tidak hanya active smoker ya, tapi juga passive smoker. Jadi hati-hati untuk passive smoker itu juga tidak hanya second hand smoke, but also third hand smoke. Jadi pada perokok ya, perokok aktif jelas lah ya, mereka inhale ke dalam tubuhnya. Tapi juga pada perokok pasif juga. Perokok pasif, misalnya suaminya merokok, atau kakaknya merokok, atau teman-teman merokok gitu ya, yang kita sering menghisap, nah itu lama-kelamaan akan merubah struktur di dalam paru kita, akan merusak ya, mengalami inflamasi, mengalami peradangan, dan ya ujung-ujungnya akan mengalami perubahan bentuk ya pada alveoli, dan terjadi gangguan pada pertukaran gas. Nah, kalau third hand smoke itu apa? Maaf ini agak keluar ya, jadi karena ini topik yang mungkin nggak semua familiar. Jadi pada third hand smoke itu pada orang perokok ya, misalnya mereka merokok, mungkin kalau di sini enggak ya, tapi misalnya di Indonesia merokok di mobil gitu. Nah, itu yang bekas rokok itu akan menempel ya pada jok mobil, pada setir mobil, dan itu akan menjadi exposure juga, akan menjadi pajanan juga pada organ, untuk organ pernafasan kita, dalam hal ini organ saluran nafas kita dan paru. Jadi ya pastikan ketika misalnya memang kita lagi meng-encourage ya, lagi mengajak keluarga kita untuk berhenti merokok, at least ketika mereka belum bisa total untuk berhenti, ajak mereka untuk peduli juga dengan keluarganya. Artinya ya ketika dekat dengan keluarganya harus ganti baju, harus mandi dulu, dan juga apa tempat-tempat yang ditempati untuk merokok itu harus dilap benar. Karena itu akan menjadi resiko untuk keluarganya ya, untuk menjadi third hand smoker. Alright. So with this immune system change, yeah, there is as we know that with aging there will be change with our immune system. But I want to explain more about the second hand smoker and third hand smoker. We already know that smoking is really bad habit, and it will change. It will change our lung the lung structure and the function, but it's not it doesn't happen only to the smoker itself, but it also cause the it also may yeah it also cause the trouble for the second and the third hand smoker. What is a second-hand, third-hand smoker? It's actually passive smoker. Yeah, second-hand smoke basically just when people smoke and we inhale the smoke from those cigarettes. But with the third-hand smoke, it's like leftover dust or yeah gas that actually for example in the car it's attached to the steer and something like this. So that particles is actually also the exposure to the to our airway and to our lung. All right. This explains that the lung aging is not only. Not only causing the impact to the breathing, but also impact to the other organs. Like, so with the reduce of the lung volume, as we know that by aging, our lung volume will be reduced, but it's not just, it doesn't only affect our lung, it also affect the other organs like cardiovascular, like the heart, the diabetes, yeah? So, even there is no clear mechanism why, like for diabetes, there is still in more study that try to find out what's the link between the diabetes and the lung function. But it might be because there is explanation that because like the lower lung capacity make the aging process become become faster. That's why it may lead to the diabetes also. Jadi ini saya hanya ingin menjelaskan bahwa terjadi interaksi ya. Jadi bahwa perubahan penurunan volume paru itu enggak hanya berpengaruh pada proses pernafasan saja, tapi juga berpengaruh pada organ-organ lain seperti jantung, penyakit sistemik seperti diabetes. Ada sebuah penelitian ya mengenai hubungan apakah ada hubungan antara volume paru dengan diabetes. Nah, memang belum ada penjelasan yang benar-benar jelas ya mengenai hubungan ini, tapi kemungkinan disimpulkan bahwa penurunan fungsi paru itu akan mempercepat proses penuaan pada semua organ. Dan itu akan ya seperti Dr. Erika jelaskan sebelumnya bahwa proses penuaan itu aging itu akan juga mempengaruhi proses metabolisme ya, dan makanya akan lebih terjadi resiko terhadap diabetes. Okay. As conclusion, many of changes are inevitable with time, healthy pulmonary aging. It depends on physical activity, proper diet, weight management, and avoidance of smoking and environmental exposures. And also it's good if you can have a lung cancer screening. Jadi sebagai kesimpulannya bahwa kita yaitu sunatullah ya, sunatullah kita akan menua, kita nggak akan bisa, iya iya suatu sunatullah lah ya, nggak bisa kita rubah, tapi kita bisa melakukan proses-proses pencegahan supaya tidak terlalu mengalami progresivitas yang seharusnya gitu ya. Jadi dengan olahraga teratur, dengan diet, dengan apa nutrisi yang baik ya, nanti akan dijelaskan oleh sister Lulu. Kemudian dengan pengaturan, dengan berat badan yang ideal, yang proper, juga yang terpenting ya mencegah merokok. Kalau masih merokok, usahakan untuk berhenti. Juga pajanan polusi ya. Alhamdulillah kita tinggal di Australia, polusi sangat minimal ya, kecuali pada bushfire tahun lalu. Kemudian bila ada keluarga yang mungkin mengalami kanker paru, itu bagus untuk screening juga. Okay, before I finish it, this is just I wanna show about the video about the breathing exercise.
Pursed lip breathing is a technique that helps people living with asthma or COPD when they experience shortness of breath. Pursed lip breathing helps control shortness of breath and provides a quick and easy way to slow your pace of breathing, making each breath more effective. When you feel short of breath, pursed lip breathing helps get more oxygen into your lungs and calms you down so you can better control your breath. To practice pursed lip breathing, sit down in a chair and relax your neck and shoulder muscles. Breathe in slowly through your nose, making sure to keep your mouth closed. Some people find it helpful to count to themselves. Inhale 1, 2. Pucker or purse your lips as if you were going to whistle or gently blow out a candle. And then breathe out or exhale all of the air in your lungs through your mouth slowly and gently through pursed lips. Try to breathe out longer than your inhale. Some people find it helpful to count to themselves. Exhale, 1, 2, 3, 4. Continue to repeat this exercise of slowly inhaling through the nose and exhaling through pursed lips until your breath becomes normal.
Okay, jadi with the pursed lips breathing, basically it's as we know that in aging lung, the carbon dioxide will be trapped more in the lung. So we need to remove it more by exhaling more. So we inhale by counting 1, 2 and exhale more by counting up to 4. So we exhale more than we inhale. So that's the basic concept of pursed lip breathing. Do we have another one?
Belly breathing, also called diaphragmatic breathing, is a breathing technique that helps individuals living with asthma or COPD when they experience shortness of breath. This technique helps to slow down your breathing so you can catch your breath and use less energy to breathe. When you feel short of breath, belly breathing helps get more oxygen into your lungs and calms you down, so you can better control your breath. To practice belly breathing, sit down in a comfortable chair. Sit up straight and put your hands on your belly. Or if it's more comfortable, you can lay down. Close your mouth and take a slow, deep breath in through your nose. When you breathe in, you want your belly to fill with air and get bigger like a balloon. Blow all of the air out slowly and gently through pursed lips as if you were blowing bubbles. Concentrate on your breathing as you continue to breathe in through your nose and out through your mouth. Repeat belly breathing for 5 to 10 minutes and relax. Just remember to keep your hands on your belly as it helps you to concentrate on the air going in and out. The more you practice, the easier it will be to calm down.
Okay, so with the belly breathing, it's basically to make our diaphragm become, it's basically like exercise for our diaphragm. So it's to like strengthen our diaphragm muscle. Jadi belly breathing itu lebih untuk melatih otot diafragma kita supaya diafragmanya lebih kuat, dan seperti kita tahu bahwa diafragma itu sangat penting untuk proses pernafasan. I think that's all from me. Thank you so much for listening. I'll give it back to Farah.
Masya Allah, Dr. Putri, jazakillah khair for sharing with us. What an insightful session. Alhamdulillah, we've learned so much ya, Dr. Putri. Saya mau berterima kasih nih sama Dr. Putri karena sudah sekalian menjelaskan pakai bahasa Indonesia gitu ya. Karena karena Farah itu kan nursing-nya di sini, jadi kalau misalnya harus menjelaskan pakai bahasa Indonesia tuh kadang tuh belibet gitu. Ngerti di Inggris, tapi kalau bahasa Indonesia tuh kadang agak belibet gitu. Jadi, dan karena sudah dijelaskan di bahasa Indonesia juga, saya nggak akan summary panjang-panjang, mau recap aja. Masya Allah ya, Allah sudah menciptakan tubuh kita tuh dengan sedemikian rupa gitu. Untuk bernafas aja, prosesnya itu melewati proses yang sangat panjang. Sedangkan kita tuh tidak, we don't think about it, because when we breathe, we just breathe, and we take it for granted that we breathe easily every day gitu. Padahal sistem tubuh kita itu Allah sudah desain dengan sedemikian rupa, dan tentunya tugas kita lah untuk menjaga tubuh kita dengan baik, dengan memaksimalkan fungsi yang sudah Allah berikan kepada kita gitu, seperti yang Dr. Putri sudah bilang. Nah, surprisingly, paru-paru kita tadi berhenti growing ya, itu waktu umur 12 tahun, dan maksimal functionnya itu untuk perempuan 20 tahun dan laki-laki 25 tahun. Berarti seperti like my age nih, itu tuh udah pelan-pelan sudah decrease ya ability-nya gitu. Itu aja, yang kita sehat aja udah menurun fungsinya, apalagi yang dikompromis dengan lung condition atau merokok ya, tadi seperti yang Dr. Putri bilang gitu. Jadi intinya berbeda ya kondisi paru-paru kita waktu kita masih muda sama ketika sudah menua gitu. Jadi memang kita harus pintar-pintar menjaga paru-paru kita dengan baik, karena itu nanti mengefeknya akan ke banyak sistem di tubuh kita. Ada sistem jantung, sistem tadi juga mungkin ada yang diabetes juga gitu. Tadi juga Dr. Putri emphasize banget ya soal smoker gitu. Jadi kalau smoker itu sudah pasti berbahaya, second hand smoker juga third hand smoker juga gitu. Jadi mungkin nggak usah banyak-banyak, segitu aja, karena Dr. Putri sudah sangat thorough tadi, Masya Allah, Alhamdulillah. Dan ini sudah ada beberapa juga pertanyaan yang masuk, nanti kita lanjut di Q&A. Okay, so next session, okay, so that's our first guest speaker, everyone, and our second guest speaker for today is Sister Lulu Eckert from Fit Sisters Melbourne. If I can get someone to share the slideshow. Yep, so I just introduce a little bit about Sister Lulu. So Sister Lulu is passionate about the fitness industry professionally and personally. With 23 years in the fitness industry, Sister Lulu has been a gym owner, a presenter, a lecturer, and is a fitness specialist who is a personal trainer, a CrossFit coach, CrossFit athlete, weightlifting athlete, and MMA fighter, and has also appeared on Series 1 of Australian Ninja Warrior in 2017. Sister Lu is also a Level 1 Karate Coach, Level 2 CrossFit Coach, Cycle Excel level one instructor and also Les Mills certified. Sister Lu has specialized in boot camps and outdoor fitness, and has opened boot camps in Australia in Cheltenham in 2012. Sister Lu loves living an active life and has competed and won many tournaments across Australia and New Zealand, as you can see on the slide. And Sister Lu was named a Fitness Leader of the Year finalist from Fitness Australia in 2008 and acted as chairwoman for Relay for Life in Warrnambool in Victoria, a position she held for 10 years. And she's also a board member of Cancer Council of Victoria Advisory Board. Mashallah, I don't know what else to say, Sister Lulu. I feel very embarrassed of myself after reading your profile, mashallah. We do want to show everyone a little bit about video of Sister Lulu. If I can get someone to share. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for the video. So, mashallah, you could all see yourself from the video what Sister Lulu is up to in everyday life. Inshallah, Sister Lulu will share about the importance of exercise and nutrition, and we all can't wait to hear what you have to share with us. Sister Lulu, without further ado, the time is yours.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Firstly, thank you so much for having me today. I'm very pleased to be able to share hopefully some tips or some information, you know, maybe that you didn't know, or some way that we can help you. And knowing the importance, I think, of a healthy lifestyle. And I think coming from a place of, you know, we're talking about, you know, from our aging or our bodies, because from the day we're born, we're aging, but it is our responsibility from Allah to protect and preserve and, you know, look after the body that we've been given in the best way that we can. And I think, you know, looking at my whole life, you know, the way that we can do this has always been a learning, you know, for myself. And it goes to show that, you know, talking about, Dr. Pitcher was talking about the smoking, and I think this is a very big thing in our communities of the second hand, especially in third hand. When I pull up next to somebody in a car and I'm seeing them smoking in the car, like I'm so against smoking myself personally, but that secondhand smoking and how it can affect our lungs and our own health. But, you know, you've got to think about our children and also our family members as well. So that was a big thing for me, because years and years ago, the smoking was legal on airplanes and in cars and in cafes and everything like that. So I'm so glad that the way that we've evolved is that it's banning a lot of it, because the lung health is a very big thing, especially, you know, with COVID and this year and looking at respiratory issues. So I suppose my fitness and my background has come from being able to help people understand at whatever level their body is at, wherever they are in regards to learning and how to eat better or how to be able to add some sort of exercise into their life, no matter what their ability, what their age, because some people will say to me, I'm too old to start that, or, you know, what you do is crazy. I could never do that. And I don't expect people to do that. I've been training as an athlete for 25 years. I'm almost 45 years old now, but I still train, you know, extremely hard. And I just don't think age is anything to me. It doesn't matter because you're never too young to start. So whether it is walking around the block for you, whether it is, you know, looking at some information online and trying to, you know, copy some sort of exercise to be doing it at home, there's always somebody that can help you. And before I go on, I just wanted to let everybody know that I'm more than happy to leave my details either via Instagram or have my details available. And I'm happy to share or assist in any questions, even after the question times, if somebody needed some sort of home program or an option for you if you had a nutrition question. So if you do miss out on the question time, I will offer myself to the community, whether it is giving you a program or some sort of link or some exercises to follow, just so that you can take that step in the right direction. So my focus today, as I'm going to talk about, is the importance of exercise mainly. Obviously my nutrition and that will come into it a little bit, but more about taking the time for you. So when we talk about the time, I mean prioritizing ourselves. So if I might just get to the next screen, if that's okay. So taking time for us to live a healthier lifestyle. So a healthier sort of day-to-day person. So if we look at our schedules and, you know, we have children, we have grandchildren, we have families that need our time. They need food cooked. They need us dropping them off here and there. Our time is consumed by our family. And I find a lot of the time, I have a lot of clients who will say to me, oh, I don't have time to do that. Now, when I hear that, I think there was a saying ages ago. I can't even remember exactly what it was, but it's if you don't take time now for yourself, you will find time for illness. So if you're not looking after ourselves, it's like that's when, you know, we have to go to the doctors or where, you know, we're the body's starting to fall apart, I suppose, in a loose sense. But we need to prioritize it just like we would with scheduling. I have to drop my children at school. In my diary, I have to, you know, do my spin class, or I have to go for a walk there. And it's finding that time so that, you know, it's in the diary, just like I'd put the washing on, making it part of our day, making it part of our week. Now, I'm not saying you have to train every day, but a nice recommended amount of fitness is trying to move every day. So we look at what are the benefits? What are the benefits for exercise, you know, on our mental and on our physical? So as we're aging, as we're getting older, I know that, you know, we start to feel a lot tighter in our body. Our muscles start to get tighter. Our bones are getting achier. We're losing strength. Our muscle mass is decreasing. So we want to try to combat this. We want to start, you know, at any level, trying to have exercise so that it benefits our mental. The way it benefits, I think, for our mental, I think keeping us more positive. So I'm not sure how you feel, but I know if I've gone for a walk or I've done a training session, when I get back from that, my mental health is better. I feel more positive, like I've done something. I feel good. Alhamdulillah, like I've made myself go and do that, and I feel very good about it. And it changes my day. And I can compare that to a day where I was like, oh, I really cannot do this today. I don't want to start. I don't want to do any training. But I know, you know, those days, sometimes my day is not as good as the days that I've actually done something. It doesn't matter, like with expectations on myself, at what level. So some days I'm like, okay, I feel I'm sore. I'm tired. I just feel stressed. But if I've just walked around the block, I've come back in, maybe a quick stretch, that's all that my body wanted today. So being kind to yourself, not putting major pressure on yourself, but if you can start to exercise, or you know how it feels when you are more positive from training, that's how that mental effect is. Let's have a look at the benefits of some sort of training or some sort of exercise, no matter what our ages is. So we're looking at living longer. So if we look at, keeping our heart working, our heart rate coming up a little bit, we're looking at trying to not be sedentary. So we don't want to be sitting still all the time. We don't want our body to stiffen up. The more that we move, the more active we are, the younger our body is going to be. We're processing everything better. Okay, if we start to think, I'm old, I'm not going to do anything, that's when our body starts to go, well, I'm just going to get tighter. I'm just going to start feeling that I can't move like that anymore. So it's just finding something that is suitable for you. If we look at our bone density, I speak to a lot of women that have been diagnosed with, they've got lower bone density. And I think if we look at osteoporosis and we look at falls, if our body is getting weaker, or we're more prone to falls because our body hasn't got the strength that it used to, or our balance that we're used to, if we're doing some sort of resistance training, some sort of exercise, we're increasing our bone density. So if we look at prevention of falls, later on, and look, my mother has just, she went hiking with my brother, and she's very, very active. She's 68, I think, maybe, I'm not sure, but she's very, very active. Like, I look at her and she's like, she looks young to me. She's moving around, hasn't done like gym work like myself, but she's going hiking with my brother, and she took a fall on the gravel and she's gone down on her wrist. This was 1 month ago, and she's broken her wrist. And then, I had to talk to her because she hadn't done a lot of work, but now she's had this wake up call. Alhamdulillah, she's like, okay, I need to do a little bit more, because her wrist was like broken. And they told her that her bone density, was quite low, and her bone, it snapped quite easy, even though she took the, her body weight. So if I look at that even for a lesson for myself, I'm thinking, okay, I remember what they're saying. Some sort of resistance work to increase that bone density is something that we do need to look at and not ignore, because all of us can lose our balance. It doesn't matter how, we can just turn out the car the wrong way. So if people think, oh, I've got to do weights, I've got to do this heavy weights, it's not about that. It's about, even I have people that go, I don't have dumbbells, especially during COVID. I've offered, a lot of Zoom sessions for my sisters, which we've been training the whole year on Zoom, and they're like, I don't have any weights. Well, you don't need them. You can do body weight movement, and that is resistance. You want to squat your body. If we're weighing anywhere between, 45 to 100 kilos, whatever you are, you still got to squat that weight. I can't squat. It's like, well, you can. You sit on the couch, you sit on the edge of the bed. To me, that's a squat. So it doesn't matter what level. And the simple things that we do is get a set of chickpea tins out of the cupboard, and all of a sudden, those are dumbbells. I have people doing chickpea bicep curls. So there's always options. It's about being inventive and like, what have we got around the house? So I've had sisters go from never exercising before online with Zoom to like fast forward to like, I'm not sure what the day is, but Thursday we last trained, and I sit back and I look at them at how they've progressed in that time. And I'm talking all ages are on this group. Okay. So there's always an option around that. The other thing we have, one of the benefits in regards to our health is reducing the risk of stroke or heart attack. So regular cardiovascular work. So it's not just about the resistance work. The cardiovascular exercise could be just as simple as a brisk walk. Some people have cycles or a bike at home, just increasing the blood flow to the heart, just to boost the overall health. So just something to get the heart rate up, just like housework does or anything, but it's just about getting out of the, not completely out of breath, but just, okay, I feel like I can still talk, but I'm getting my heart rate up a little bit. So it doesn't need to be extreme, but it's moving. think I talked about my bone density. Another one I was reading a report on about reducing the risk of dementia. So being sedentary in our later years increases the risk of developing dementia. So they're saying that for older adults, if we're not exercising, they're more likely to increase signs to develop dementia. So there's a lot of things that, you know, exercise is doing and why we should keep moving. And in regards to this also, it's also other diseases. So if we know that our body is functioning good, we know that we're doing the right thing for our exercise, and it's going to prevent or delay other diseases, you know, coming up in life. In regards to one especially, so keeping a healthy weight as well. So if we look at diabetes onset, my father-in-law, he's been naughty with eating the wrong foods and, you know, getting a little bit more sedentary through winter and everything like that. And he had the onset of type 2 diabetes. And then trying to teach him about walking, we got him a bike for his home in Sydney, but he didn't understand how the foods he was eating were affecting this diabetes. And then the extra weight that he had gained was also assisted with that onset. So then he had a little bit of high cholesterol as well. So we need to look at all of those things around heart and the cholesterol, the diabetes, also the arthritis as well. So sometimes when we get a lot of pain from arthritis, people are like, oh, I can't do that because my wrists hurt or my fingers hurt. But sometimes we just need to just get moving. And it, you know, as I said before, it can be anything in regards to that. It's something that suits the person. So I think when I talk about the next point is finding something that you enjoy. I don't want it to be a task. I don't want you to go, oh, Lily showed me the videos. She's crazy. She's doing all this weight. I can't think of anything worse than that. You know, that would kill me. But I would look at a walk and go, oh my gosh, walking. I got to take my iPad or something, you know, because walking for me, I just can't do it. But people love walking, or people love going to the beach and wading through the water. So what I'm trying to tell you is there's something for everybody, no matter of your age or what you can do, whether it is stretching, whether it is sitting down and standing up against the couch, 10 of those per day, standing up and we're going through some arm circles and we're doing some stretching. There is so much to do. It is just about getting that body moving and liking it. We can, the way we can find things, especially through COVID, has taught me that I had to evolve as a trainer. I had to learn how to be motivating on a Zoom call and then, you know, being able to hurt somebody in a nice way through the screen. So my clients have said to me, you are just as mean, maybe meaner, through Zoom. She goes, I think I like this so much that I'm going to continue. Instead of driving from where she lives to come and see me, she goes, I can do this at a time that suits me. It's 30 minutes of my day. I turn it on. She goes, I feel like you're in my lounge room. So even if it was just a check-in with somebody that you know that is a coach or has some knowledge in fitness or health. I mean, otherwise I said, I'm more than happy to assist with this outside of this presentation today to get people moving. If that's what you want to do and you're not doing anything now, it would make me very happy if I had somebody contact me and said, I need to start training. Can you please help me with a bit more information or point me in the right direction? Or, you know, maybe we do a little online Zoom 30-minute stretch class or balance class or a little strength session. I'm more than happy to do that. So if that's something that people want, please, please let us know. So we need to find that enjoyment factor, because if I have the fire in my belly of like, oh yes, today I'm going to go and train with my training buddy and we're going to do deadlifts, that excites me. So I'm excited about going to training. And then it's not a task. You know, then it's not a task. But if, you know, maybe it's yoga that does that for some people. It's like, I love the feeling after exercise. Sometimes it's not at the time. Like I could be pulling a face. I'm not, I don't like this. This is not nice. But down deep, it's as soon as I finish, those endorphins and the red face and the sweating, and I like that feeling. And it becomes a little addictive. Like for me, that is my That is my go-to. It's like a cup of coffee. It makes me feel good. I really, really enjoy that post feeling of exercise, and I'm in a much better headspace for the rest of the day. So, like, for example, this morning, I got up at 6 o'clock to leave the house to get organized. And then I have a class. We start at 6:45 this morning, and I had 10 people outdoors, and we all meet, we all do it. And one girl, she says to me, oh, I have nothing today. I don't feel like this. I said, you know what? You're here. So you go at 60%, you just do what you can, just don't do that, don't do that. We just change it to suit her mental that day, her how she feels. She's had a hard week with travel or work. And then you know what? She left. Then she goes, I feel amazing. I just did something, but I did it at what I could do for today. So it's about, tailoring it to how you feel on that day. So that brings me to my next point about the benefits of social and group exercise. So that could be anything from meeting a group of sisters and we're all going for a walk. We're going to meet at 2 o'clock in the park and we're all going to go for a 30-minute walk and catching up, or you're talking because you can be social because we're all so good at talking. We love it. But imagine instead of drinking coffee and having a cup of a piece of cake, we could go for a 30-minute walk and get a lot of that chitter chatter out of the way. And then we could stop and have like fruit and a healthy snack, a cup of tea, you know. So there's ways that we could change our lifestyle but still be social. And it brings us together. It keeps us together. So through COVID, even though I'm a coach, I need accountability. So it sort of goes into my next point. But on the social side, every morning, Monday to Friday at 9 o'clock, because I didn't have the school run, one of my clients that became my friend became my training buddy. So we would Zoom each other. I would have done my spin class. I've done a bit of cardio. And then at 9 o'clock we meet and we have these stretch bands and we do this little booty session, which is like all glute and leg work. But because she's there on the screen and she says, I'll be there. I have to be there because otherwise she'll go crazy at me. We meet and we do the workout together on a video, or we set the workout ourselves. So that accountability gave me motivation to be on there because I couldn't let my friend down. We talk, we do 10 to 15 minutes of this horrible, horrible bottom and leg workout, but then it's done. And then I'm like, okay, I did it. I feel good. So this is motivating me to do that. So it's as simple as like getting your friend, and you can do it online still. Like even though our restrictions are easing, a lot of us are still arranging Zoom sessions and motivating each other to do this. And I have had feedback from clients, some saying, I can't come back to training. I can't, because I've gained so much kilos over COVID. I've gained weight, or then I've got people that have lost weight. So this went into emotional eating, maybe changes of craving, you know, humans and the interaction in our social groups, that they, they were eating more, they're home with their family more, we're cooking more. So a lot of cooking went on during COVID. And instead of having lots of friends or family to share the food with because we're stuck at home, a lot of people just eating it more themselves. You know, they're eating more because they'd made the same amount of food they normally have, but we didn't have the community to share it with unless we were dropping it off to friends. So I found there's a lot more food in the house. But for some, on the other hand, on our nutrition side, COVID gave us a little bit more control. So if we are being more, the restrictions were high, but we're being a little bit, I know for my household, we're being smarter with how we're spending. So we would make the meals or the shopping go further. I wasn't eating as much because I felt like I wasn't running around as much. The kids were home, but instead of they weren't eating from boredom, it was more controlled, you know, putting more time into our food, and then, you know, planning our meals a little bit more. So being able to look at someone's food diary and their nutrition and look at, okay, where am I going wrong here? I've been training for the last 2 years. I go to the gym. I'll go walking with my sisters. Why aren't I losing weight, Lulu? So sometimes I look at their food diary. I say, can you please write it down for me? You know, she goes, I eat well. I'm not too bad. And then I look, she's eating okay. But then we look, and if you cut down and we look at what she had for breakfast, and we look at the lunch, we look at the snack, or we look at the quantity. So sometimes it's not the food, it's about the size of the portion. So if we look at, she's like, oh, I'm not losing belly fat, it's growing. So I have to look at carbohydrate. I have to look at how you're processing your foods. Are you doing enough exercise in order to be, you know, burning that off? But sometimes I find in different cultures, we're looking at the rice, or some of my Indian clients, we're looking at the roti, like the bread, all carbohydrates, and they might not be doing enough of the exercise to burn that off. So we just make a few tweaks in people's diets. Perhaps we can sub that out for, we can stir fry more green vegetables and reduce your rice portion down, make sure we have more of the proteins, and looking at the sweets and the sugar contents of foods as well. So we look at all these yummy foods or the cakes or the sweets and everything like that, and we want that, but trying to have more willpower about, okay, today you're not going to have cake and coffee. We have the tea and fruit, or we have the crackers and some dips or something like that. There's a lot of options where we can still enjoy it and have a nice social and nice tasty food, but we can, you know, look at different options. And sometimes that comes from education and not knowing what is available or what options I have, or just finding it hard to change your habits. So in regards to exercise and nutrition, a lot of the time we're just stuck in our habits that we've been doing for 20, 40, 60 years, because that was the way that my family ate. This is what my mum's given me, but now my body's changing. So as I've evolved and as I've grown older and as I've like thinking it, I got to 40 and I was like, why is my stomach getting fatter? I haven't trained. I haven't changed my training or my food. You know, I couldn't get over it. I couldn't understand, but you know, metabolism slows down. It slows down. We're not processing it. So I found as I got older, I don't actually need as much food as I needed when I was 35. So as I've gotten older, I'm happier with smaller portions in my stomach to digest. And like, I feel good, because if I do eat too much, I just feel bloated. And I find a lot of the weight is going into the upper part of our tummy. And that's where we store it. And then also like hormonally, sort of like lower, you know, your lower belly as well, especially if we've had children. So our body shape does change. We just have to embrace it. This is our body. This is what we need to care for. You know, we can't go on like, we're not in the movies or these celebrities that just snap their fingers and have all these operations done. And like they have a baby and the next day they're walking, you know, and these, you know, you don't even, you know, it's not real life. Our real life is us being the way we are, embracing the age we are, changing our food, changing our exercise, changing perhaps any supplementation that we need as we grow older, making sure that we're going to the doctors for checkups if something is going on or not feeling right. Not all the time, but like, you know, if there's something not feeling right, then go and get that checked, because the worst thing we can do is avoid this and then we have actually got something going on, you know. So we need to care for our bodies. You know, we've been given this body and it is our responsibility to look after it in all aspects. It's not just, you know, it's not just like, oh, I'm going to be good for a week because I need to fit into this dress because I've got my friend's wedding. It's not short term like that. Every single day of my life, like you know, it's just there. Like I have a water bottle next to my bed. I drink that. I have my fish oil that I take, and it's an ongoing thing that I like to do. If you look at it as a form of worship as well, that's, I think of looking after my body as a form of worship, because it is my responsibility. It's what I've been given. So I need to respect this body. It's every single day about putting in the time for you. And as I talked to my first point when we started, was prioritizing that time for you, and, you know, why the exercise and healthy living is, you know, one of the most important things for you. Because without that, and you start to show signs of disease or arthritis or things that are going on with your body, later on, if you're just going to say, oh, well, I would have, how about you actually do it? So from today, I want you to take something away from this. And if you're thinking in my head, oh, I could actually do that, get a diary out. Like if you use a diary, I mean, there's so many phones and everything. I actually use my old school diary and everything is logged in here, between clients, school drop off, pick up, when I'm going to eat, what time. It's actually all written down, because I need to see it. But please, I want you to take away from this and take time for yourself. And for those that are mothers or grandparents, everything like that, there's sometimes guilt associated with making time for you and saying, okay, I'm going for this walk at 1:30. I'm going to go for a walk. I'm going to do this. The dishes, the washing, it's all going to be there for you. We can prioritize our time to like get things done a little bit later just so you can have that time. But please don't use that excuse of I don't have time. Because if you say that you don't have time, you're talking about your health, and it should be number one for you. Because without your health, how are you going to be a good parent? How are you going to be a good grandparent? How are you going to work? If you're not functioning properly, then you're just running on empty. So we need to really, really need to sort of rethink about, what is actually important. So little steps to take away from here. What can you do right today? How are you drinking enough water? Like, are you drinking 3 cups of coffee and 2 cups of tea? Well, there's a lot of caffeine right there. Are you drinking 2 to 3 liters of water? You're like, whoa, I can't do that. I'd be on the toilet all the time. But as soon as you go through 2 or 3 days of drinking 2 liters of water, your body will calm down. If you say I'm fluidy, okay, you need to drink more water, because if you have fluid retention issues, it's because you're probably not drinking enough water. So we combat that with more water. We flush your system out. So how can you go, okay, I can cut cake out I'm going to eat it only on Fridays, or I'm going to cut my roast portion down. I'm not going to eat rice with my nighttime meal. I'm going to eat rice with my lunchtime meal. Little things like that are going to change you. So are you eating enough vegetables? Is there enough veggies in that diet? It's like, oh, I had this sandwich for lunch. I had meat. I didn't actually eat vegetables today. So have a look at your own diaries and think, okay, we all know what we should be doing, but how can we make it better? So little tweaks, just little steps. It's not about, okay, next week I'm going to run every day. Next week I have to drink 3 liters of water every day. It's little steps, bit by bit. We make changes and we get better. And you're having someone to check into. So sometimes it's good to get a training buddy, someone you can talk to, or a sister that you got to say, okay, well, we're going to look at our food diary from now on. We're going to cook better, or share recipes, things like that. So sharing with each other, and then you can actually motivate each other instead of going, oh, I've got to do everything on my own. I think it's really, really good to have someone you're accountable to and share with, that, you know, even a walking buddy once a week, it can make a difference. So, well, that is all on my agenda. So as I said before, please, my contact details will be available for anyone. If my WhatsApp details or Instagram can be handed out to anybody, if you're not getting a chance to do questions, or is something that you would like to address privately that you didn't want to in the question time. So thank you so much for having me speak today. I hope that you got something out of this to take forward, whether it's on your training or on your food, anything like that. So, assalamu alaikum. Thank you.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Jazakillah khair. Sister Lulu, what an inspiring talk indeed. I think it's a very good reminder for all of us here. And actually, I work in a hospital, and I do have patients who are 90 years old and they look like they're 60. Because they've lived a very active life, they've lived, you know, a very healthy diet, and it really shows on you, it really shows on them. And I have had patients who are 60 years old and they look like they're 80, because they've lived a sedentary lifestyle. So
yeah,
I think, that's right. So it all comes back to us. So Sister Lulu, jazakallah khair. I'll try to summarize a little bit in Indonesian, if that's okay with you. Seperti bapak-bapak dan ibu-ibu sudah dengar tadi di talknya Sister Lulu ya, sebenarnya tuh kita semua sepertinya sudah tahu apa yang seharusnya kita lakukan. Jadi bagaimana cara, mungkin tips-tips yang bisa kita lakukan, yang bisa kita mulai lakukan gitu. Sebenarnya kita tuh semua sudah tahu gitu. Tadi Sister Lulu bilang first point itu prioritizing time for ourselves. Jadi mungkin kita, kehidupan kita sudah disibukkan dengan kita mengurus anak-anak kita, mengurus grandchildren kita gitu. Tapi sebenarnya tuh yang kita juga perlu mementingkan diri kita sendiri, karena kesehatan kita harusnya nomor satu, dan itu akan berdampak pada keluarga kita juga. Dan kalau kita menunggu kita punya free time, sepertinya kita tidak akan pernah punya free time gitu. Jadi penting sekali untuk meng-schedule-kan waktu untuk diri kita sendiri, untuk bisa olahraga gitu. Kemudian olahraga itu bukan hanya memberi manfaat kepada kesehatan fisikal kita, tapi juga kesehatan mental kita juga gitu. Jadi kalau misalnya kita setelah selesai olahraga itu actually sebenarnya kita akan merasa wah I did it gitu. Jadi merasa merasa we have a good mind gitu. Jadi kalau misalnya kita mungkin kalau kita sumpek di rumah, kalau kita punya emosi yang perlu kita salurkan, kita bisa coba menyalurkan itu lewat exercising. Kemudian tadi Sister Lulu juga mention some benefits of exercise juga ya, bisa mencegah berbagai banyak macam penyakit ya. Jadi banyak sekali sambungannya kepada kesehatan jantung kita, kesehatan tulang kita, kesehatan level kolesterol kita di tubuh kita. Jadi itu memang exercise dan eating a healthy diet itu banyak sekali dampak baiknya untuk tubuh kita. Kemudian pentingnya juga kalau kita bisa memiliki seseorang yang bisa memotivasi kita juga. Jadi kita semakin terpicu gitu. Jadi kalau mungkin sendiri itu susah, mungkin kita bisa meminta partner kita atau teman kita untuk membantu mengingatkan dan juga membantu saling memotivasi satu sama lain gitu. Dan sepertinya menurut saya poin yang penting juga adalah jangan jadikan, ini dari Sister Lulu ya, jangan jadikan olahraga itu sebagai sebuah beban gitu. Jadi penting untuk diingat bahwa kita harus melakukan olahraga yang kita sukai. Jadi kita tidak memikirkan itu sebagai beban gitu. Aduh, saya harus ini, saya harus itu. Tapi sesuatu yang kita enjoy gitu. Jadi kita bisa mulai pelan-pelan mencari mungkin olahraga kecil-kecil yang kita memang suka melakukannya. Jadi kita termotivasi dan akhirnya kita melakukan olahraga itu juga. Dan tadi last point yang Sister Lulu bilang ya, I think kita kalau misalnya mau mencoba apapun aja susah, mau mulai susah, mau mulai yang simple susah, mau eating healthy diet itu susah, mungkin mindset kita perlu diubah. Jadikan ini sebagai bentuk rasa syukur kita kepada Allah yang telah memberikan tubuh kepada kita ini dengan sedemikian sempurnanya ya. Jadi sebagai effort kita untuk menjaga tubuh kita, sebagai rasa bentuk syukur kita kepada Allah gitu. Jadi kalau kita menjadikan ini semua sebagai ibadah, nah jadi poin plus satu dapat gitu, sehatnya dapat, pahalanya dapat, jadi insya Allah win-win gitu. Jadi semoga kita semua semakin terinspirasi dan semakin semangat dan termotivasi untuk mulai being active gitu, dan juga mungkin health start to eat healthy diet gitu ya. Jadi masya Allah, what a very inspiring talk. Jazakallah khair, Sister Lulu. So I try to summarize a little bit in Indonesian. Okay, so just bear with me in a sec. So that was our talk for today, everyone. If bapak-bapak and ibu-ibu would like to ask some questions, also you can write them in the chat box below, and we already have some questions. However, before we move on to the Q&A session, I just want to show a little bit about video advertisement of small businesses that we have in our community. So again, I want to mention that Muhammadiyah and Aisyah Australia are very supportive of small businesses around us. And if Brother Wildan can share the video, that would be great. Jazakallah khair for the video. So that was Quran class alteration, Ali Aziz and Blue Star Drone Solutions. Please contact them directly or feel free to contact through us if you would like to know more about them. Now we're entering our Q&A session, and unfortunately Sister Lulu has to leave very soon. But I think there's the questions on the chat, Sister Lulu has proactively answered them herself as well. Jazakallah khair, Sister Lulu. What time do you have to go?
I'm just answering some of the questions now, so I've still got another 5 minutes before I'm going to take my son somewhere.
Jazakallah khair. And I think you've already answered a lot of the questions here as well, so thank you so much for that. I'm just looking through here. Feel free to answer them with talking if you like, if you have 5 more minutes.
Yeah, so I think I've just got a question here. Aurita, so it's talking about fiber. I think, especially if we're consuming like a Metamucil or something on a regular basis, I think this is okay for a morning type supplementation, especially if you're not getting enough fiber in your diet or you have constipation or slow bowels. But my thoughts on relying on some product, if that is the issue, we're not getting the fiber in order to go to the bathroom, you know, as much as we should be, what else can we do? And I do revert back to water. If we're drinking a little bit more water, because sometimes we have slow bowels or our digestion is slow, because perhaps water can assist with that. So, or we look at fibers from foods and not relying such, you know, just on a fiber. But if your doctor has recommended this because you're eating a balanced diet and you still have low fiber in your diet, then by all means, you know, this is something that you can have. So I just think with some supplements, making sure that there's not a big, you know, sugar content or things like that. So.
Yep. And I think there's also another question here, Sister Lulu. Is there tips how to increase our body's metabolism when we're young, when we're aging, how to increase our metabolism?
Yeah, that's a good question, actually, because in regards to our metabolism, some people will say to me, oh, I don't really eat much. So I should be like losing weight, but they're gaining weight or holding body fat. So if it's weight loss that they're looking for, but sometimes if we don't eat enough food, we slow our metabolism down because our body's going to store the fat. So a way that we can increase our metabolism is simply eating smaller portions of food more often. So I've sort of trained my body to sort of get hungry to 2.5 hours. So if we have something in the morning when we're rising, then maybe we have a snack, a banana or some nuts or something, you know, a little bit later, then we have some lunchtime, then we have a little bit more snack in the afternoon. And when I say snack, I don't mean chips or bad things. It's good foods, even a yogurt or a chopped up banana with walnuts I like to eat. And then I have my nighttime meal. So especially because our metabolism does slow down as we get older. So I find smaller portions and like a little bit more frequent. So it's not called snacking all day, but like maybe 5 smaller meals and just spacing it out. And that will increase metabolism. And your stomach will start to tell you when it's time to eat. They'll go, I'm hungry now. It means you're burning through the energy better, more efficiently.
Jazakallah khair, Sister Lulu. And Sister Lulu has kindly left her details on the chat box below if anyone wants to contact her directly in the future, inshallah. So Jazakallah khair, Sister Lulu, for today's session.
It's good to talk to everybody.
Thank you very much. And we also have some questions here for Dr. Putri. Let me just scroll up here. I think the very first question that we have for Dr. Putri, apakah ada yang bisa dilakukan untuk mencegah atau mengurangi pengaruh aging terhadap fungsi paru? Tapi sepertinya yang menanya sudah bilang terima kasih sudah terjawab. Mungkin Dr. Putri, if you want to add anything in regards to that, atau sudah terjawab, atau please feel free. Sepertinya masih mute ya.
Iya, pakai bahasa Indonesia ya, jadinya ya.
Boleh, silakan.
Ya, jadi untuk Tante Minok ya, Tante, jadi untuk ya mencegah aging progressively pada paru, organ paru ya, tadi sudah sempat dijelaskan di akhir mungkin. Iya, ya, kita harus mengurangi, sebisa mungkin mengurangi pajanan terhadap smoking ya, terhadap rokok dan juga terhadap polusi. Kalau di Indonesia itu yang masih common ya, mereka pakai apa, biogas, kompor yang ini. Nah, itu juga pengaruh. Jadi intinya gas-gas itu mengurangi pajanan terhadap gas-gas yang berbahaya. Kemudian yang kedua, ya olahraga ya, olahraga. Walaupun kita tidak bisa meningkatkan volume paru kita lagi, tapi at least tadi ya, kita melatih supaya otot diafragma kita tidak makin lemah, terus ya, yang apa, untuk ribs, jadi muscle ya, melatih muscle yang di daerah yang sangat berperan untuk proses pernafasan. Jadi itu ya mungkin kayak olahraga-olahraga yang mungkin yang bisa saya tambahkan, misalnya seperti berenang ya, bagus itu untuk pernafasan, kemudian yoga, kemudian untuk pada elderly juga itu bagus untuk brisk walking. Ya, mungkin Dr. Erika udah sempat jelaskan ya, jadi kayak jalan ya, jalan cepat itu bagus, 30 menit at least. Jadi ya intinya untuk tetap kita harus melatih otot pernafasan kita gitu. Nah, sebenarnya kalau di Indonesia kita ada senam ini sih, senam asma, senam, jadi kayak senam jantung kan ada ya. Nah, itu kita juga punya senam pernafasan. Itu diciptakan oleh apa, dokter paru di Indonesia gitu. Dan mungkin ya begitu Tante. Insyaallah dan ya.
Terima kasih Dokter Putri. Nanti sore Tante Minuk langsung exercise ini pasti. Jadi bukan meminum pil ya untuk mengganti exercise, tapi langsung beraksi. Masya Allah.
Insya Allah. Betul, betul, ya? Insya Allah.
Kemudian ada pertanyaan berikutnya. Ini Dokter Putri agak over sedikit, nggak apa-apa? Atau are you free? Okay. Kita ada beberapa pertanyaan lagi. Dari Tante Yanti bertanya, Assalamualaikum Dokter Putri. Saya mau nanya, kenapa para ex-smoker yang di rumah sakit, walaupun mereka sudah quit berpuluh-puluh tahun yang lalu, kenapa masih perlu ditulis ya di past medical history-nya, meskipun udah quit 30-40 tahun yang lalu. Sama juga nih, pasien-pasien parah banyak juga yang tetap ditulis. Jazakillah khair.
Yeah, it's a really good question ya. Jadi memang history of smoking itu penting sekali, karena tergantung berapa lamanya, kita hitung ada namanya indeks Brinkman. Kalau di jadi ada dua hitungan. Kalau di Indonesia kita pakai indeks Brinkman, kalau di sini pakai smoking pack years. Ya, yeah, basically sama aja. Jadi dihitung seberapa banyaknya. Semakin lama, semakin bertahun-tahun merokok dan semakin banyak pack-nya, yaitu akan semakin besar resiko untuk terjadi perubahan struktur pada organ parunya. Jadi untuk terjadi emfisema itu akan lebih sangat beresiko dibandingkan dengan yang merokoknya mungkin hanya setahun, cuma sebatang sehari gitu. Dibanding dengan misalnya pasien yang sudah 30 tahun merokok atau 20 tahun sehari satu bungkus. Nah, itu jelas akan sangat berbeda nanti dalam menentukan diagnosis dan prognosis pasiennya.
Gitu. Terima kasih Dokter Putri. Jadi meskipun udah lama quit tetap akan berimpak ya.
Iya, mau nambahin lagi. Jadi intinya sudah terjadi perubahan struktur ya pada alveolinya, terutama pada alveolinya tadi ya, sama pada elastisitas parunya. Kemudian yang ketika misalnya pasien itu sudah terdiagnosis PPOK COPD. Terdiagnosis biasanya nanti dilakukan lung function test ya, di spirometri pasiennya, terus di ya ada pemeriksaan lebih lanjut ya kalau misalnya memang di sana cenderung ke arah COPD. Nah, dengan pasien yang sudah hidup dengan COPD tidak akan bisa membaik. Jadi artinya penyakit ini akan terus berprogres. Gitu. Akan terus memburuk gitu. Yang bisa kita lakukan bagaimana supaya progresivitasnya tidak secepat yang seharusnya gitu, dengan berhenti merokok misalnya. Jadi ya jadi yang apa yang misalnya masih merokok ya usahakan se ya ini ya sekuat mungkin untuk bisa berhenti.
Insya Allah habis ini semua yang masih merokok akan berhenti, Dokter Putri, insya Allah. Kemudian ada pertanyaan berikutnya dari Tante Ori. Apakah ada hubungan langsung COPD atau any other lung disease dengan swallowing difficulty?
This is also a really good question. Dan ini ternyata masih menjadi area yang penelitian Uni Ori. Jadi ini masih menjadi area research yang saat ini masih harus diperbanyak. Masih limited sekali research tentang ini, tapi secara umum pada pasien COPD kan sudah terjadi perubahan pola bernafas ya. Nah, perubahan pola bernafas ini ternyata tidak hanya terjadi di apa tadi kan kita udah lihat ya, ada trakea, ada bronkiol itu ya. Nah, ternyata ya itu sudah mulai terjadi di atasnya juga, di upper airway-nya pada COPD ini. Nah, pada proses menelan, kita di atas trakea itu ada laring ya, paling atas. Nah, laring ini Allah ciptakan untuk ketika kita makan, laring ini akan menutup trakea, sehingga makanan tidak masuk ke dalam saluran nafas. Nah, tapi pada pasien yang mengalami gangguan menelan, misalnya pada pasien PPOK ini, karena perubahan pola nafas dan itu terjadi koordinasi yang kurang baik gitu, di mana si laringnya harus menutup trakea ternyata terlambat gitu. Jadi, nah itu akan terjadi sis apa ada makanan yang akan masuk ke saluran nafas itu yang kita kenal dengan namanya aspirasi dan itu bisa menjadi resiko infeksi gitu. Mungkin juga hal lain ya pada PPOK kan yang pada COPD itu yang paling sering juga gejalanya dia batuk kronik ya. Jadi batuk dan dahaknya banyak. Ya dan mereka sulit untuk mengeluarkan dahaknya dan itu ya jadi juga untuk gangguan menelan. Tapi itu memang lagi penelitiannya lagi dilakukan juga di MMC oleh salah satu teman sejawat. Jadi memang itu masih area yang lagi diteliti terus.
Terima kasih Dokter Putri. Intinya mah dari satu masalah ya bisa mengefek ke yang lainnya juga gitu. Ada juga pertanyaan ini, pertanyaan untuk Dokter Putri, apakah penderita hipertensi paru dapat membaik keadaan parunya? Dan eksersis apa yang baik untuk membantu menjaga kondisi paru dan jantung kita?
Oke, pulmonary hypertension ya. Jadi ya pulmonary hypertension juga ini pulmonary hypertension ini kaitannya juga dengan organ jantung ya dan memang ya unfortunately juga kondisinya tidak maksudnya nggak ada yang bisa membuat untuk mengurangi gitu ya tapi mencegah yang bisa dilakukan adalah mencegah progresivitas untuk secara umum sih exercise yang baik ya untuk kondisi paru dan jantung ya harus disesuaikan. Jadi dilihat dulu sih pasiennya ya apakah pasiennya menggunakan oksigen selalu menggunakan oksigen dalam sehari-hari ya. Jadi apakah harus dilihat dulu klinis pasiennya sendiri gitu. Kalau untuk secara umum exercise untuk paru dan jantung, ya tadi ya olahraganya meningkatkan heart rate, tapi nggak ya jangan sampai yang paling bagus tuh yang saya pernah pelajari itu ya, yang paling bagus adalah brisk walking ya, jalan cepat 30 menit, tapi ya itu harus dilakukan secara rutin minimal 2-3 kali seminggu gitu. Dan tapi ya lagi dilihat pasiennya, misalnya pasiennya memang dengan jalan cepat dia malah memperburuk sesaknya ya ini lagi. Jadi tapi kalau secara umum jalan, berenang, yoga kesini juga dipertimbangkan baik bagus ya untuk organ pernafasan juga. Ya itu Farah.
Iya, terima kasih Dokter Putri. Ini baru aja ada juga pertanyaan lagi, kalau masih boleh jawab. Assalamualaikum Dokter Putri, adakah batasan makan telur dalam satu hari? Terutama untuk penderita trigliserida, jazakillah khair.
Iya, jadi untuk telur, waalaikumsalam warahmatullah. Untuk telur itu kan memang yang bikin kolesterol itu kan ininya ya, kuning telurnya ya. Jadi kalau putih telur mau 4 itu boleh. Tapi kalau misalnya kuning telur, ya usahakan saya pribadi udah sangat membatasi ya. Jadi karena itu memang akan meningkatkan kolesterol level kita. Jadi kalau misalnya sekali bolehlah, tapi jangan jangan tiap hari juga gitu. Kalau mau makan telurnya ya mungkin ya yang paling aman adalah putih telurnya. Pasien-pasien paru kalau di persahabatan itu untuk meningkatkan protein mereka itu disarankan untuk 4-6 butir putih telur setiap hari. Karena termasuk protein yang paling baik dari telur.
Terima kasih Dokter Putri. Jadi ini mungkin next time kalau kita bikin telur balado gitu ya, mungkin makannya yang putih telur baladonya saja mungkin. Nah, ini ada satu pertanyaan lagi Dokter Putri. Ini mungkin Farah lihat itu viral ya dulu awal-awal COVID gitu ya, topik ini gitu. Penggunaan masker, kalau misalnya kita lagi COVID nih, semua harus pakai masker kan. Kalau misalnya kita tuh pakai masker terus gitu di luar, itu apalagi kalau untuk healthcare workers ya, ada Unianti, ada semua banyak juga tuh harus pakai masker terus, kemudian face shield, belum lagi di Indonesia yang pakai hazmat. Nah itu kondisi untuk ke kita overtime-nya gitu nanti bagaimana Dokter Putri kira-kira?
Iya, kalau we don't have any choice ya. Pertama sih itu ya. We don't have any choice, karena untuk benefit dan risk-nya, jelas manfaat penggunaan masker jauh lebih tinggi dibandingkan resiko yang lain, misalnya seperti kita ya dehidrasi, ya lebih exhausted, gitu. Jadi, mengimbanginya ya memang dengan kita tetap yang ya more water, gitu. Terus juga ketika kita memang sudah bebas dari tugas, ya harus tetap physically active, usahakan tetap olahraga. I know it's hard ya, karena saya lihat sendiri adik gimana keseharian adik saya gitu ya, mengurus pasien COVID. It's really ini overwhelming, dan ya memang sampai sudah nggak bisa nggak ada waktu untuk take care of themselves gitu. Tapi sebenarnya ya ideally ya kita harus mengusahakan gitu, karena in long term gitu ya, ya kita organ-organ yang lain kan juga tetap harus kita perhatikan gitu, physical fitness yang lain gitu ya, organ jantung kita gitu. Kalau misalnya kita tidak terbiasa dengan olahraga ya kardiovaskular resiko-resiko untuk penyakit jantung juga akan lebih cepat gitu.
Iya, jazakillah khair Dokter Putri, masya Allah untuk ilmunya hari ini. Semoga Allah memudahkan kita semua untuk memahami dan bisa mengaplikasikan ilmu-ilmu yang sudah Dokter Putri sampaikan ke kehidupan kita sehari-hari. Amin ya rabbal alamin.
Mohon maaf lahir batin kalau ada salah, insya Allah jadi ilmu yang bermanfaat.
Masya Allah, jazakillah khair. Dokter Putri, very busy, very very busy schedule, but still has time for us to share. bersama. Terima kasih Dokter Putri. Okay. Now, as much as we would like to keep going with the questions, I'm afraid we have to end it here because that it's already past the time. Yeah, it's already past 11:45, and mashallah, time just flies when you're having a great discussion. Again, I would like to say a massive thank you to our guest speakers for the day, Dr. Putri and also Sister Lulu, who's already left. Indeed, we have learned so much from today's seminar, and may Allah reward you with overflowing rewards. Amin ya Rabbal Alamin. And more importantly, I would like to thank all the participants who are present here today. It's our fourth session today, and it's great to see some familiar faces from the previous sessions. May Allah make it easy for us to apply the knowledge we learned from today to our everyday lives. Amin ya Rabbal Alamin. I would like to let you know that our last session of Welcoming the Golden Years is coming up in 2 weeks' time. It will be our fifth session and it is our last session. And inshallah, we will have the topic is going to be about mawaris dan juga wasiyah yang akan dibawakan oleh Dr. Ahmad Muhammadiyah Diponegoro dan juga Muhammad Adel dari Wasiyah Islamic Wills Made Easy. Jadi it's going to be a nice closing topic for our big Welcoming the Golden Years event, inshallah. And we're hoping to see you all again there. It will be held in 2 weeks' time on the 21st of November from 10 o'clock to 11:45, inshallah. Now I would like to invite Ustaz Wahyu to assist us in closing the seminar with a closing dua.
Yeah, assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ya, mari kita tutup workshop ini dengan doa. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin. Hamdan yufi ni'amu wa huma yukafi mazidah. Rabbana lakal hamd kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa 'azimi sultanik. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين Allahumma inna nas'aluka salamatan fid din wa afiyatan fil jasad wa ziyadatan fil ilm wa barakatan fi rizqi wa tawbatan qabla al maut wa rahmatan inda al maut wa maghfiratan ba'da al maut Allahumma hawin alaina sakaratil maut Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina adhaban nar Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun 'alal mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Amin rabbal alamin. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Jazakallahu khair Ustaz Wahyu. Now, normally I would like to invite Pak Abdu to lead photo session. However, Pak Abdu is here today. So still, as always, we're still going to take screenshot of everyone who have attended today's session. If anyone would like to turn on the video camera, please feel free to turn it on now. I think we have two pages. Oh, one page, is it? Oh, we only have one page now. Okay, please. This is our second last session, so it's a good time to take photo. Feel free. Hang on, let me just make my screen a little bit bigger. Okay. Anyone else? Okay, yeah. I think Manita is going to take it from her phone and I'll try to screen capture it from my computer. Okay, if everyone is ready. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, I think it sounds like I got it. Okay, Pak Abdul always does twice, so let's do one more time. He will be very proud of me after this, I think. Okay, yeah, ada Tante Wati is here also. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay, alhamdulillah. Jazakillah khair, everyone. Masya Allah. Okay. Sebentar ya. Oke, okay. Kalau gitu terima kasih semuanya ibu-ibu dan bapak-bapak yang sudah hadir hari ini. Masya Allah, very beneficial. Semoga kita Allah memudahkan kita untuk bisa mengaplikasikannya in our everyday life. Jazakumullah khairan kasiro everyone once again. Insya Allah, we will